Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of Leaving Yesterday by Kathryn Cushman, narrated by Christina Moore and directed by Greta Cohn. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Kathryn Cushman. This recording is copyrighted 2010 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. And now, Leaving Yesterday.
Chapter 1. My son was dead. I knew it the minute I saw the black and white car pulled to the curb in front of my house. Clods of potting soil still clinging to my gloves, like the debris of the last few years, clung to everything in my life. I turned back to my house, walked up the porch steps, opened the front door, then closed and locked it behind me. Perhaps a reasonable person would understand that the clink of the deadbolt sliding into place did nothing to stop the impending news. Well, show me the mother who thinks with reason when faced with the news that her only remaining son is dead. I walked into my kitchen and tossed my gloves on the counter, ignoring the splatter of soil they left over what had been spotless granite. I grabbed a cup from the top shelf and shoved it against the slot in the refrigerator door, holding it in place with such force I thought the glass might shatter. Cold water filled it almost to the rim. Just taking a little break from gardening, that's what I was doing. That policeman outside had turned onto the wrong street, that's all. He had probably realized his mistake and was gone by now. I took a seat at the kitchen table and opened the home improvement catalog that sat atop the mail pile. I thumbed mindlessly through page after page until one particular ad reached out and wrapped its fingers around my throat. The boys in the photo looked nothing like Nicholas or Kurt, other than the fact that my sons had once been boys that size. Still, looking at the picture, I couldn't help but remember them as their 8 and 10-year-old selves. A smiling father held up the latest power drill beside the treehouse in progress. His smiling wife stood atop the latest, greatest ladder. Even the chocolate Labrador at the bottom of the picture appeared to be smiling at the two boys who stood beside the pile of lumber. A world so full of promise. Just like ours had once been. The chime of the doorbell brought me back to the present and reality. A reality I didn't want to face, but I had to. Time had just run out. As I walked toward the front door, it occurred to me that these would be the last steps I would ever take without knowing for certain that Kurt was dead. I needed to hold on to this time for as long as I could, remember each step as something precious. One step, two, three. At 10, I reached the door. I took a deep breath and put my hand on the brass handle, still smeared with dirt from my useless attempt to shut this moment out. In spite of the fact that I didn't want it to, the lock pivoted beneath my fingers. There was no turning back now. I tugged at the front door, surprised by how heavy it felt, and then came face to face with my worst nightmare. Only what I saw didn't match the image I had expected. Everything about the officer's appearance surprised me. Missing was the grim undertaker expression on a face sagging with age and sorrow. At the very least, I expected a strong undercurrent of discomfort from the poor, unfortunate officer saddled with delivering this kind of news. Instead, his demeanor was pleasant, almost amiable as he looked at me. His reddish hair and youthful freckles reminded me of a grown-up version of Opie from the Andy Griffith Show. Alicia Stewart? I held onto the doorknob for support, waiting for the blow to come. Yes? I'm Detective Bruce Thompson from the Santa Barbara Police Department. He didn't say more. I supposed he was giving me a chance to respond with some pleasantry or to ask about the nature of his visit. I didn't. What could I possibly want to say to him? We both knew what was coming. Why would I want to ask the question that would bring on the inevitable? I simply stared at him and waited. He shifted on his feet and finally looked down at a small pad of paper he carried in his right hand. You are Kurt Stewart's mother, is that correct?
Yes.
Again, he waited. His military short haircut stood at attention, as if it too anxiously anticipated my response. What was he expecting? I'd answered the question. That was more than enough talk for me. Finally, he asked, "Do you know where we might find him?"
What?
The doorframe beside me seemed to waver. I reached my left hand to grab it for support.
You're not here to... You're looking for him?
He looked as confused by my response as I was surprised by his question.
Yes? Is he here?
I turned to lean my back against the doorframe and slid to the ground. Detective Thompson knelt beside me.
Are you all right?
I'm fine. It's just that I thought you were here to tell me that he was... I rested my head on my knees and took deep breaths. Deep, freeing breaths. My son was still alive. To Detective Thompson's credit, he waited quietly beside me, giving me a chance to pull myself together without any clumsy attempts to be helpful. Finally, I looked at him and shrugged.
I thought you'd come to tell me that you'd found my son dead.
How many years now had I dreaded just such a visit? To an addict's mother, it was woven into the fiber of daily existence as completely as the fragile thread of hope, and often with more clarity. Detective Thompson rubbed his hand to his forehead.
I am so sorry. If it had occurred to me what you might think, I would have stated up front that everything was okay.
I became aware of a woman walking her golden retriever on the sidewalk across the street, eyes fixed right here on my front porch. It didn't take much of an imagination to know what kind of story this could make around the neighborhood. I stood up and gestured weakly back inside.
Would you like to come in?
He nodded and followed me in. Whatever his reason for the visit, it didn't matter. My son was alive.
Here, let me get you some water.
A moment later, we were seated at my kitchen table, the magazine still open to the family treehouse picture. I touched the face of the smallest boy, suddenly thankful for his presence.
Back to my earlier question, is Kurt staying here? Do you know where I might find him?
I shook my head. I haven't seen him in over a year. I took a sip of my water, feeling the coldness slide down my throat.
We have a young daughter, and my husband believes...
I stared out the back window at a group of crows roosting in the giant oak on the other side of our fence. I envied the lack of complication in their existence.
Well, at some point a parent has to quit enabling bad choices. You know, tough love, all that.
I looked into his eyes, wondering what a police officer thought about tough love. Did he see it as the cruel, uncaring act that it often felt like? Or did he see it as the necessity that wricked it? As a mother, my head told me one thing, my heart another.
I understand that.
It was stated as a fact, nothing more. Not an agreement or a disagreement, just the truth of his understanding.
So you have no idea where I might find him?
No. The last I heard, he was working odd jobs at construction sites around town, but that was a while ago. As the fear of Kurt's death ebbed away, reality set in, and another fear began to grow and take its place.
Why are you looking for him? Just routine questioning.
He flipped up a sheet on his pad of paper. I reached my hand across the table and grabbed his. He looked up, his eyes wide with surprise. Detective Thompson, in the last few years, I've lived through one son's violent death and the debilitating addiction of another. My husband has recently left home, and I am using the last ounces of strength I possess to make it through each day and be here for my daughter. I cannot afford to be blindsided. I need to know how bad this might be.
He drew his hand away, studying my face as he did so.
Surely a detective trained in interrogation could take one look at me and see the depths of desperation, know beyond a doubt that I spoke the truth. After a moment, he shrugged and said,
"A drug dealer was killed downtown last weekend. I'm just looking to ask some questions." Why would you want to question Kurt?
Again, he searched my face before deciding to offer a response.
Do you know what a pay-o sheet is?
No.
It's a record that drug dealers keep of people who owe them money. In that line of work, somebody always owes you money.
I guess so. I focused on my glass of water. The ice cubes were slowly shrinking and disappearing, just like I was.
Am I to assume that Kurt's name is on the, what did you call it, pay-o sheet of this drug dealer?
Yes, it is.
And that makes him a suspect.
I stated this as a resigned truth, something I'd mastered over the last few years. Resigning myself to all sorts of unsavory truths had become one of my strengths, if you could call it that.
Your son's name was on that list along with more than a dozen others. He's not a suspect. We're just doing some routine questioning, hoping he might be able to shed some light on who might have done this.
Yes, of course my son's name would be on the list of people who owed a drug dealer money. He had descended just that far since his brother's death. Still, I knew Kurt well enough to know that he did have limits on how low he could go. Detective Thompson, my son may be an addict, but he is not a murderer.
I'm sure you're right. There are over a dozen names on the list, and it's highly likely that none of them killed the guy. It could have been a member of a rival gang, another drug dealer, anyone. We're just looking for pieces of the puzzle right now.
Relief flooded me. Of course they didn't suspect Kurt.
Well, sorry I don't have any more information for you. Thanks for the water.
He pulled a card out of his pocket.
If your son should call or come by in the next few days, would you let me know?
Would I? I wasn't sure, but I did know that my son would not be calling or coming by. His father had made certain of that some time ago. It was a safe answer.
Of course.
I took the card and held open the front door for him.
Detective Thompson, if you should see him before I do, will you tell him?
He waited for me to finish the sentence. What would I want him to know? That he was ripping my heart out? That I desperately needed to see that he was okay?
Just tell him that his mother loves him.
He nodded and smiled.
You got it.
Chapter 2. It wasn't a hard decision to keep quiet about Detective Thompson's visit. Rick wouldn't be by to pick up Caroline for another couple of days, and I saw no reason to call him and tell him any of this before then. Besides, I already knew how he would respond, with a 5-minute tirade about how worthless our son had become. Rick had long ago determined that the reason for Kurt's problems was that we had been too soft on him. I'd heard countless renditions of, "We just made his life too easy. He never learned to take responsibility," etc., etc. It didn't matter how much I reminded him that Kurt had been an honor student and outstanding athlete, that he'd worked part-time to pay for his own used car and performed a couple hundred hours of community service. The answer always came back to soft parenting. Out of curiosity, I dug through the recycling bin until I found the story of the weekend's murder. A local man was found beaten to death just outside De La Guerra Plaza early Sunday morning. Due to the severity of the beating, the victim was not easily recognizable but has since been identified as Rudy Prince. Mr. Prince was well known among local authorities as a small-time drug dealer who had been arrested numerous times and convicted on 3 different occasions for aggravated assault. Police believe the murder weapon was likely Mr. Prince's own Louisville Slugger. According to sources, he used to carve a tally mark in the handle of the bat each time he beat someone with it. The wooden bat is currently missing, and police are urging anyone with information of its whereabouts to please call the toll-free hotline. My son owed this man money, the man who carried a baseball bat with tally marks. I shuddered when I thought of all the things my son was experiencing that were far too horrible for me to even comprehend. How had that happened? Just then, Caroline came bounding in from school, her cheeks flushed with excitement.
Hey, Mom, can we get a puppy? Holly Jeter's mom brought theirs to school today, and he was so cute. I really think we need a puppy.
Life is so simple when you're 10. A new puppy solves everything.
I kissed her mop of sandy hair and smiled. What do you think Boots would think of that? She looked toward the bundle of sleeping cat in his usual spot by the heating vent in the corner, then walked over and buried her face in his fur. You'd like it just fine, wouldn't you, boy? You'd like to have a doggy brother, wouldn't you? Boots lifted his head and looked toward Caroline with feline annoyance before stretching, flashing his claws in the process. See, Mom, he wouldn't mind. Besides, since Dad's not here anymore, we need some protection. You know, a guard dog sort of thing. Yeah, right. Now sit down and eat your snack. As she removed some ice cream from the freezer and took a seat at the kitchen table, I tossed the newspaper back into the bin and thought again how much Caroline looked like a younger, feminine version of Kurt. The two of them were so much alike in so many ways, it almost seemed as though they were twins. Twins with an 11-year difference in age. She put a spoonful of ice cream in her mouth and then another, with no conversation in between. This, in and of itself, was unusual. Then I noticed she was staring at the front door as if transfixed by the dark stain of the mahogany or polished shine of the brass handles. I had cleaned off the dirt from earlier but began to wonder if I'd missed a spot. I tried to follow her gaze but couldn't see anything unusual. What are you looking at? I'm just watching for Kurt. The expression on her face was so matter-of-fact that it broke my heart. Why would you be doing that? Last night I dreamed he came back home. Jenny says sometimes dreams tell the future, so I'm just watching. I was certain that the man she looked for had the same winning smile and easy laugh that had once been such a part of Kurt. She undoubtedly pictured his loose, sandy curls swaying in time as he played the air guitar, or felt the tickles in her ribs from former wrestling matches. In her mind, he was still healthy, happy, and wonderful. He just wasn't around anymore. Somehow the innocence of childhood seemed to erase her bad memories of the last years before he disappeared completely. The timing of her dream couldn't have been worse, what with the detective's visit today. I was glad she hadn't been home when he came by. At least she'd been spared that. Why don't we go for a walk? Maybe we can stop by Holly's house and you can show me her new puppy? Yay! I knew you'd come around. She jumped up and threw her arms around my neck. Just wait till you see him. You'll want a new puppy, too. I promise you will. As much as I dreaded the next few weeks of puppy begging this impromptu outing was bound to cause, it was worth it to get Caroline's hopes off Kurt's arrival. At least she could visit Holly's puppy, pet him, hug him, something she would never be able to do with Kurt. Later that night, when I tucked her in, I gave her an extra long hug that brought tears to my eyes. She knelt to say her prayers and began immediately with, "Please show us the right puppy for our family. Help Mom to understand how much we need one." When she got to her usual, "God bless Kurt," I didn't have the typical mental response that Kurt was too far gone for even God's help. Instead, I found myself pleading right along, "Please, please, please." I left her room and sank beside my own bed to pray. "Father, help him. Father, help him." It was as articulate a prayer as I could offer when Kurt was involved. Chapter 3. The next day, I walked across the street to Lacey Satterfield's house for our usual Tuesday morning breakfast and gab session. Lacey was a 60-something widow who had moved to our sleepy little neighborhood about 5 years ago and had had everyone talking. Our street was full of 40-ish-year-old homes, nice but not fancy, priced considerably higher than houses in similar neighborhoods because we were in the best school district. Why would an older single woman pay extra for that? Besides, she was a retired lawyer. But the rumor on the street was that she hadn't actually retired, she'd been disbarred. No one seemed to have actual substantial details, but few doubted the truth of the rumor either. I was her one and only friend on the street, and I didn't ask. Having a son who is an addict helps a person understand the principle of leaving private things private. The exterior of her home had been redone by its previous owner in white and gray minimalist modern, but once inside, it was a return to the Victorian era with lace, linen, and dark wood.
Lacey herself was an eclectic mix of just about everything. She always wore sweatsuits. I'd never seen her in anything else. And they were always in one shocking shade of neon or another. Today's outfit was lemon yellow, with a matching sequined headband holding back shoulder-length gray hair.
"Come on in," she welcomed me. "I just pulled the scones out of the oven, or there's biscotti if you prefer."
I followed her inside and went through all the usual motions of mixing cream in my coffee and putting food on my plate. I sat at the walnut table and offered the only small talk I could think of this morning.
"So, what's new? Have you got your spring vegetables planted?"
Gardener though I was, I couldn't have cared less. There are more important things to discuss this morning, but I didn't want to jump right in with my real question. Better to work my way into this slowly.
"Nah, I don't think I'm even going to plant this year."
Lacey's voice had the gravelly sound of a woman who'd spent most of her life smoking a few packs a day.
"My back's too old and stiff for all that. Besides, we can buy perfectly fresh vegetables at the farmer's market every week. What's the point?"
Normally, I would have argued about the sense of accomplishment, breathing the fresh air, working in the sunshine, whatever. Today, my thoughts and energy were moving in other directions.
"So, I was just reading my newspaper. Have you seen that story about the drug dealer that was murdered downtown last weekend?"
I hoped my tone sounded as casual as I intended. She nodded once, tilted her head to the side.
"Yeah, I saw it."
I fussed with my lace napkin before setting it neatly on my lap.
"What do you think about it?"
"What do you mean, what do I think?"
She coughed once, then continued.
"That boy was a thug if ever there was one. He sold drugs to teenagers. He beat no telling how many people with that baseball bat he always carried. I think if the police do find out who killed him, instead of pressing charges, they ought to award a medal. Maybe even the keys to Santa Barbara."
Lacey had a strong opinion about many things, but this one surprised me more than most.
"Do you really think so?"
"I think you know me well enough to know that I do."
She took a bite of the cranberry scone she'd made that morning and nodded.
"I find it downright poetic that the killer beat him to death with his own baseball bat. It's almost like an eye for an eye, you know. I can't think of a more appropriate way for him to die. If our justice system worked a little more like that, we'd all be better off."
I dipped a chocolate macadamia biscotti in my coffee, watching the top layers soften. I held it up, but didn't take a bite. "Kurt is one of those people of interest the police keep talking about." I nibbled at the cookie simply because I needed to do something.
"I wondered as much."
Her tone was as matter-of-fact as if I told her that the weatherman had predicted fog tomorrow morning. Why this surprised me, I can't say for sure. Lacey had always had more than the average insight. Still, I looked at her faded blue eyes, at the small wrinkles that surrounded her lips, and wondered again if it were a mere mortal that inhabited her worn-out body.
"You did? Why?"
"Well, for one thing, it would explain that policeman that came to your door yesterday. He stayed quite a while. It was obvious he had something to say."
"How did you even know he was here?"
"Baby, I live on this street. You know, I'm home most of the day."
"But I saw you in the driveway last night. We talked for 5 minutes and you never mentioned it."
"I don't go poking around in places that aren't my business. Last night you didn't bring it up, so it wasn't my business."
"And now?"
"Now that you've mentioned it, you've made it my business. So I plan to give you my complete and honest opinion, if you want to hear it, that is."
"You know I do."
And I truly did. Lacey never spoke fluff. What she said was what she meant, without exception.
"I didn't know Kurt too long before he cut the strings on his parachute and had his free fall, but I knew him well enough. He's lost his way right now. There's not much doubt about it. But there's not a mean bone in that boy's body, and there's no doubt about that either."
She took a sip of coffee.
"Kurt's just not the beat someone beyond recognition kind of person. Anyone with half a brain can see that. I don't expect they'll be interested in them for long, but like I said before, whoever did it should be congratulated.
What a relief to know that someone else saw the absolute certainty that Kurt couldn't have done this thing. Still, Lacey and I were not the two opinions that mattered most in this case. Every time the phone rings, I'm afraid to answer it. I keep thinking it will be the police telling me they've arrested him. I know he didn't do it, but what if the police don't see it that way? Her index and middle fingers twitched as if they were holding an invisible cigarette. She raised them to her lips and drummed a slow beat.
Would it really be worse than what you've got now?
She leaned back in her chair and braced her arms against the table.
I mean, no mother wants her son to be accused of murder, but at least you would know where he is. You'd know that he's still alive, for crying out loud, eating three squares, maybe getting some help.
There was some truth in what she was saying. I can't argue with that. But there's also the other side. It would mean I raised a killer. The well-mannered young man that I raised to hold open doors for women, to say please and thank you, to clean up after himself. I thought I was doing everything right. My throat closed, effectively choking further words.
You were and are a great mother. Don't ever doubt that.
I pictured myself walking into the church staff meeting and trying to explain to the governing board that my youngest son was no longer just a prodigal, he was a murderer. I could see their faces. The senior pastor, kind but disapproving. The director of missions, shaking his head in disbelief. The two secretaries, whispering behind uplifted hands. The hope that Kurt will eventually return. My daughter, my work at church. Those are the only things I have left in my life that matter. Nick's death took so much away from us all. If Kurt killed that man, there won't be anything left. Lacey leaned across and squeezed my hand.
Like I told you, Kurt's not the one who did that. We both know it.
Sometimes the police get things wrong. She looked out the window at this statement, but nodded her head oh so slightly.
I'm afraid I've seen too much of this world to argue with that one.
She took a sip of her orange juice, which I suspected she occasionally laced with something a little stronger.
You're still a great mother to Caroline, and you would be even if the worst came to pass. Nothing can change that. And I wouldn't expect any of this to affect your church work. The people there, they all know about Kurt, right?
Sure, they know he's an addict. They know he started using drugs after Nick's murder. But they all see me as the woman who counsels people in their grief, the one who stands with God through storms and dark times. How can I continue to counsel families who have lost loved ones if they believe my son is out there killing people's loved ones?
Never have understood the church crowd. Don't expect I'll start now.
She stood up and carried her plate to the sink.
I'd give anything for a smoke right now.
She tossed the remaining orange juice down the sink.
Seems kind of silly to me that I stopped at my age, especially when the damage is already done.
Lacey spent nights and several hours each day hooked up to portable oxygen, although she always refused to wear it during our breakfasts together. Well, you don't want to do any more damage. Besides, I'm sure it would be dangerous to smoke while you're using oxygen. Wouldn't it explode or something?
I don't know, baby. I don't know.
She took the plate from my hand and rinsed it in the sink before loading it into the dishwasher.
I just wish I knew that at some point I could once again do the one thing I really want to do. It's not like I'm on a diet and there's hope for a piece of cake after I've lost the appropriate amount of weight. I can never, ever smoke again. And it's all I can think about. There's no hope, and it's maddening.
That would be me if Kurt got arrested. I thought about the strong facade I'd put on for so long. Yes, my oldest son had died in a brutal attack. Yes, the grief of that had driven his younger brother into a world of addiction. Still, somehow, it would be easier to tell people I had a prodigal than a murderer. All hope fled by simply changing that one word, and hope was all I had to keep me going these days. The only problem was, I didn't even know what to hope for anymore. Chapter 4. When the phone rang at 8:13 Wednesday morning, I was standing in my recently remodeled bathroom, thinking how the separate his and her closets had sure turned out to be wasted space under the circumstances. I was hurrying to put on my makeup. In this particular case, it was brown eyeliner. I'll never in my life pull out my brown eye pencil again without remembering that exact moment. Sort of like most people have triggers that remind them of the day the Berlin Wall came down, or Pearl Harbor, or 9/11. It's amazing how close I came to missing the moment altogether, considering for a long moment just letting the call go to voicemail. I was already running late, and the only people who called these days were telemarketers. But something made me pick it up.
Mom, it's me.
Kurt's voice was little more than a whisper. Just the sound of it poured over me like the sweetest of symphonies, barely remembered but desperately yearned for.
Oh, Kurt!
The joy of saying his name lasted no longer than the word on my lips. A picture formed in my mind of my son at the police station, getting his one phone call. There was no other reason he would be calling.
Kurt, are you okay? Where are you?
I tried to remember Lacey's words to convince myself that even if he were arrested, it really could be the best thing for him.
I'm fine. I'm in Orange County.
You're where?
Mom, I'm in rehab.
Rehab. Oh, the hope that had remained buried beneath the word prodigal for so long burst forth like a ray of sunshine after years of rain.
I knew it! I knew it would happen! Oh, Kurt, I am so proud of you. How long have you been there? How are you doing? Can I come see you?
His laugh sounded weak.
Oh, there, Mom, take it easy.
I heard him take a couple of deep breaths. Then he continued.
I've been here for a little bit. I've finished the detox process.
He gave a low whistle.
That memory will keep me clean the rest of my life. It must have been awful.
I'd seen enough about withdrawals and the like to know it had been terrible. I pictured my son shaking, sweating, crying out in pain. Still, a part of me was grateful for it, if the memory of it helped keep him clean.
It was hard. This call's even harder.
I could hear him take another breath.
I'm sorry. For the drugs and the lies, and for going off the deep end at the time when you needed me most. I shouldn't have let you face that alone.
Alone. Kurt didn't even know his father hadn't lived here for the last few months, and yet he'd said the word alone. That's how far we must have fallen as a family.
Oh, Kurt, you're forgiven. When can I see you?
They tell me I'll be an inpatient for maybe 6 or 8 more weeks. When I start to get out, I'll give you a call.
A muffled voice sounded in the background.
Oh, time's up. I've got to go. Love you, Mom. Wait!
But I was too late. The line went dead. He'd hung up the phone before I had the chance to find out where he was, the phone number there, or even a second to voice a response. I stared at the wall, trying to ignore the ache in my chest. In spite of everything that had happened, he knew I loved him with all my heart, even if he'd hung up before I could say it. Right? Almost immediately, I picked it back up and pressed the button for the caller ID. At least I'd know where to call him. The screen lit behind the black lettering of the display. Private caller. I sank onto my bed exhausted, trembling. A few moments with my son was more than I'd had in over a year, but all I wanted now was more. But I had no way of reaching Kurt, of finding out where he was, checking on his progress. In that moment, I vowed that this would never happen again. I walked around the house and made sure there was a pen and paper in every room. The next time Kurt called, I would ask for his number and write it down before we talked about anything else. I just hoped there would be a next time.
Mom, aren't you ready? I'm going to be late for school.
Caroline stood in the doorway, her fists pressed against her hips.
I ran to her and threw my arms around her.
Oh, sweetie.
She pushed away and looked up at me.
What's got you acting so weird?
Kurt just called. He's getting well.
Kurt's coming home?
She threw her arms around me and squealed in that high-pitched way only a 10-year-old girl can. Her immediate assumption that he would be coming home took me aback. Perhaps I shouldn't have said anything to her about this yet. But everything inside of me screamed that she was right. I reached down, picked her up, and swung her in a circle. Together we began to chant, "Kurt's coming home! Kurt's coming home!" And every time we said the words, I came to believe them just a little more. Through a miracle of speed, determination, and sheer luck, I managed to drop Caroline at the front of the school with 2 minutes to spare. I watched her skip toward the door, her blonde hair bouncing with each step. A small voice of worry kept whispering in my head, saying Kurt wouldn't call again. He wouldn't make it through rehab. It wouldn't last long. Maybe I shouldn't have told Caroline anything after all. Who wanted to see her hopes destroyed? I turned my car toward the church and began to sing Amazing Grace at the top of my lungs. Maybe I couldn't stop the internal voice of doubt, but I could at least drown it out. I found it hard to sit still during the morning staff meeting. The music director told of his plans for a children's summer choir. The children's director revealed plans for vacation Bible school, detail by painstaking detail. All these things were treated with utmost importance, and I knew they were important. Really, I did. Our church was the fastest growing church on the Central Coast. We were gaining a lot of notice, and it was an honor to be a member of this team. But today, I couldn't think about anything other than my son.
Alicia, I know the spring women's Bible study is well underway. I've been getting a lot of positive feedback,
Ken Maddox, the senior pastor, said as heads nodded in agreement all around the table.
What do you have in the works for the women this summer?
I shook my head. I've found that with kids out of school, family vacations, etc., it's more frustrating than fruitful to try anything structured. I am planning a weekly Meet at the Beach event for mothers and their children, and a couple of family movie nights throughout the summer. Our program's coordinator, Beth Williams, shook her head.
You know, now that our attendance is averaging over 1,000, you might want to reconsider. If not right away, at least by the end of the summer, when construction should be complete on the new family living center. I'm thinking we should take full advantage of the facility as soon as possible. Use our talents, that sort of thing.
I pretended to write a note on the pad in front of me. Thanks, I'll keep that in mind, Beth. Ken Maddox cleared his throat.
There are a couple of other things I'd like to discuss with you. First of all, American Christian Magazine wants to do a feature on our church, and they want to spotlight you in particular.
I looked at him in shock. Me? Why?
Well, our women's ministry department is flourishing, and someone on their staff was present at the last Living with Grief seminar we hosted this winter. They were impressed.
He looked down at his notes.
Speaking of, I understand you are planning to speak at the upcoming seminar next month.
He smiled toward Beth.
And of course, Beth will be there to make sure everything runs smoothly.
She bobbed her head as if in time to some unseen music.
That's my gift.
I sighed.
Yes, it definitely is.
Organization was Beth's gift, there was no doubt about it. But she was so type A that she was overbearing to work with for any length of time. I tried to avoid doing so as much as possible. I looked toward Ken.
I wonder if we should be looking to feature someone else next month. I could help plan the event.
Beth broke in.
I told her that was completely unacceptable. I can organize these things just fine, but people come from miles around because they want to hear Elise's story. She does such an amazing job.
She looked at me as if God himself had just spoken. Then she began to trace her notebook with her finger and added demurely,
to tell you the truth, though, I wish you would avoid answering the questions about the effect on your family in such detail, especially the part about Kurt. It just seems so depressing and hopeless, especially after your talk has been so uplifting. I had come into this room with no intention of telling what was happening with Kurt, but Beth, in her usual way, riled me up enough that I blurted, "Not anymore. I guess I have a new chapter to add to my story." The room went dead quiet. Everyone at this table knew the story of Nick's death, of Kurt's resulting fall. They'd all been praying for him, just like I had for the past few years. This morning, I got a call from Kurt. He's in rehab and in the process of turning his life back around. I blinked the water from my eyes, wanting to see their faces. Ladies and gentlemen, it would appear that my prodigal is on his way back home.
Well, hallelujah, Ken shouted, and the others added their own praises, each voice building my joy. We had all been praying for Kurt's return, even though it seemed it would never come. Through the years, I'd begun to wonder if we were just wasting our time, praying about something that God couldn't be moved on. In this moment, I was so glad that I'd never expressed my doubts to this group, never let them know how much I feared that God wasn't listening. Now I stood before them and shared their joy, with no spoken words of which to be ashamed. It was a perfect way to end the meeting. After the meeting, Ken asked me to come into his office and motioned me to take a seat.
This can't top what you've shared, Alicia, but you're doing a wonderful job here. Folks have noticed, and the overseers have voted to move your position to full time, starting this fall. Pay would be significantly more, of course.
I could use that. I didn't have to say why. He knew Rick and I were separated, our future unclear, but with the way things were headed, I was likely going to need more of an income at some point. My only concern with going full-time would be needing to be home for Caroline after school, at least when she's not at Rick's.
Of course, I knew you would feel that way, and I'm sure we could work it out so that you could do some of your afternoon work at home.
Sounds good. I stood up to return to my office, but he waved me back down.
There is one more thing I wanted to talk to you about, but not in front of everyone else.
I dropped back into my chair.
What? You know that editor friend of mine I've been telling you about? Well, I sent him a couple of articles that you've written and a CD of your talks. He's interested in talking to you.
Really?
I tried to keep my voice steady, but the jolt of excitement that hit me with this news dwarfed the news about going to full time. Speaking was something others wanted from me. Writing was something I'd always dreamed for myself. A book. Nick had always been such a reader, and to be able to put at least a little of his life on the page forever. This day was turning out to be the most wonderful in recent memory.
Here, Ken continued, handing me a printout. He gave me a list of things he'd like you to email him. A summary, chapter titles, an opening paragraph, I can't remember what all. I'll be praying that God will lead you in this, as he has in all things.
Thanks, Ken. I took the paper from him and returned to my office, happier than I'd felt in a long time. As disjointed as my life had been for the last few years, the pieces were finally beginning to fit back together. I spent the rest of the afternoon thinking about how I would spring the news of Kurt's turn to my husband. Tonight was obviously the right time, since he always picked Caroline up from softball, then ate dinner at the house before loading Caroline and her things into his truck for her three-night stay. We had planned it that way so Caroline could see things were still okay between us, that we didn't hate each other. The one thing we had done right through all of this was to try to make our separation as easy as possible on her, no matter how hard that made it on us. Should I tell him when he walked through the door? Let him eat first? I ran the various scenarios through my head, and in my fantasy, no matter when I gave the news, his reply was always the same.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.